This is the day the Lord has made. We should all rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome, my brothers and my sisters, to The Bridge. This is a part of the weekly teaching ministry of the St. Paul's Baptist Church in Central Virginia, where I am blessed to serve. If this is your first time, I invite you to text the word NEW, N-E-W, to 804-643-4769. Give us a chance to greet you. If you would like to be an insider, which means that you'll automatically receive our student outline every week in your email box, you can text the word insider to that same number, 804-643-4769. But we welcome you with joy and with enthusiasm and with excitement. Would you take a moment, stop right now, and welcome somebody in the chat space, regardless of what platform you're on. Give them a great big hello, shout them out by name as we prepare to share this study together. And we want to share this study. I don't want you to be passive. I want you to feel free to like, to comment, to share, to post your emojis, to post your questions in the chat space, because we want to grow together. you can download this student outline if you don't already have it. There's a link available in the chat space on all of our platforms. And again, as I said, if you want to receive it automatically, text the word INSIDER to 804-643-4769. Get your outline, get your Bible, get your writing utensil, something with which to write, or if you're going to type, get your fingers ready as we prepare to study together. This is a series on Ephesians, the New Testament book of Ephesians, that we are calling a crash course in Christianity, because that's exactly what it is. And we are in chapter one. We're going to look tonight, take a deep dive in, or today rather, into verses 15 through 19. But first, let us pray. God, we give you glory and honor and praise for your goodness in our lives. Would you bless us now as we join our hearts and minds together by way of technology to grow deeper in your word, to grow stronger in the faith in this crash course in Christianity. Guide our thoughts now and help us to see what we cannot see on our own. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to tag this lesson with the title today, A Prayer of Enlightenment, because that's exactly what chapter 1, verses 15 through 19 provide. As we come to this section in Ephesians, Paul has completed his song of celebration, a record-setting 203-word sentence in which he successfully celebrated their mutual blessing and redemption, and finally, their salvation. But though the song has ended, he has not stopped celebrating, because he now goes on to praise God for the practical outworking of the blessings he has been singing about, as evidenced by the faith and love of the Christ followers in Ephesus. In verse 15, he says, "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers." And thanking God for their faith in Jesus, Paul is, of course, praising God for their saving faith. And I draw a distinction there. They have been saved by grace through faith and not by their own merit or effort, as he's going to make plain in chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. Their boast was in Jesus Christ alone, and that was something for which they could all, along with us, thank God. But Paul was also giving thanks to God for their practical faith, what I want to call everyday faith, or how we work faith out from day to day. When you, my friend, took your first step of faith towards God, you may not have known God very well, but you knew God enough to trust God with your heart. And as you get to know God better, God will prove God's self trustworthy, faithful, reliable, dependable in your life. And as a result, your faith in God will continue to grow. While salvation is a free gift of God, Romans 6:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And in Romans 6:23, it says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, the free gift of God, is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." While salvation is that free gift, growing everyday faith, practical faith, requires discipline. The whole spiritual life is an exercise in maturing, growing discipline. And here are a few practices very quickly that I didn't add to your outline today, but they will help you to get to know God better. One is to read and study the scriptures. That's why lessons like this are so important. The Apostle Paul encouraged one of his proteges, Timothy, to continue learning from the scriptures. He wrote these words there in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. This is out of the New Living Translation. Paul said to Timothy, "These words, the scriptures, have given you the wisdom to receive the salvation that comes by trusting in Christ Jesus. And he goes on to say, all scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip God's people to do every good work. God reveals God's self through the scriptures. So one, read and study the scriptures. Two, learn and practice prayer. Pray about everything. Paul tells the Philippians, tell God everything you need and thank God for all that God has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. That's Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. Prayer is our connection to God. So the second step is to learn and practice prayer. The third is related to that, which is where you listen for the voice of God. God speaks to us in many ways, but in order to hear God, we must cultivate habits that help us to listen. Habits like setting aside time for a devotion, meditating on scripture, listening to the teaching of the scripture, worshiping God through what the Bible calls psalms, hymns, and songs of the Spirit with gratitude in your hearts. That scripture is found in Colossians 3:16. And Jeremiah 33:3 assures us that if we call on God, God will answer. So the third thing that helps us to live out our faith is learning to listen for the voice of God. The fourth is meeting with, fellowshipping with, interacting with other people of faith. That's why I started today by saying, greet the people in the chat space. You want to interact with people who are headed in the same direction you are headed, who are trying to grow in the same way that you are trying to go. The writer of Hebrews admonished these early believers in Hebrews 10, 24 and 25, let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, but encouraging one another. Through fellowship with other people of faith, we learn and grow together. And as Proverbs 27, 17 reminds us, as iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. The next step you want to take in terms of living out your faith is to step out and serve. Jesus set this example for us by serving other people. His ultimate act of service was sacrificing his life for you and me. And Jesus Christ calls upon us to serve other people in his name. You can read about it in Matthew chapter 25, verses 34 through 40. This should be our natural outpouring of gratitude to Jesus Christ. In James 2:26, the text says, just as the body is dead without breath, so then faith is dead without good works. We have to step out and serve. It's not enough to study. It's not enough to meditate. It's not even enough to pray. You have to serve God. And we serve God by serving other people. Now, I'm still in my lesson in Ephesians because the Ephesian church not only rested its salvation, but also its everyday life on Jesus Christ. The Ephesians believed that Jesus Christ would take care of them through thick and thin, ups and downs, advances and setbacks. Their faith was not like the man of whom I've often spoken, who the story is told about, who was attempting to cross the frozen St. Lawrence River in Canada. Unsure whether the ice would hold, he first tested it by putting one hand upon it. Then he got down on his knees and gingerly began making his way across. When he got to the middle of the frozen river, he's trembling with fear, crawling across, and he heard a noise behind him. And looking back, to his horror, he saw another man in an Escalade cruising across the ice. You got to get that. See, if only he had known and believed and realized how thick and firm, dependable and reliable the ice really was that day, he could have made progress a whole lot faster. And so can we. The Ephesians knew that Christ had saved them and could hold them up. He was reliable, dependable, firm, could be depended on. As a result, the Ephesian believers were charging straight ahead. And for this, Paul thanked God. I'm blessed to serve a church who functions and behaves like that. They believe God. They stand on the promises. So they serve God. They pray. They worship. They study the scriptures. We are growing together by the grace of God, having a kingdom impact in Central Virginia and beyond. This Ephesian church, paired with their exemplary faith, was their love for all the saints. Now, significant here in this text is the word all. They loved all of their fellow believers, those whom they liked and those whom they didn't. Don't miss that distinction. You have to love everybody, whether you like them or not. Did you hear what I just said? You got to love everybody, whether you like them or not. The reason this is so striking in this text is that it is often not true in Christian circles. As Jonathan Swift, a clergyman, so rightly observed, we have just enough religion to make us hate, but not enough to make us love one another. This kind of surface Christianity arms people with what we think and believe are proper prejudices and a rationale for criticizing those who fall short of what we think they should be, giving us a basis to keep them at arm's length. But not so with the believers in Ephesus. That is why this word for love here is agape. Everybody say agape. Now type it in the chat space, A-G-A-P-E, agape, a thoughtful, volitional, purposeful love that wills to love even that which is unlovely. This is the very love of God Almighty. The Ephesians had this love in their hearts through the work of the Holy Spirit. Read Romans 5:5 when you get a chance. And they chose to exercise it in relationship to one another. You will not like everybody, but by the grace of God through the power of Christ, you can love everybody, even the unlovable. The attitude among the Ephesians was my life for your life. I once saw a picture that somebody had drawn of what they thought hell looked like. It showed several obviously selfish, unhappy, mean, negative people seated around one table for a meal. Each of them had a long-handled spoon with which, and the spoon was so long it was impossible for them to feed themselves. They could only feed each other, but nobody at that table was willing to do it. And of course, that's what made it hell. There was none of this in Ephesus. They looked out for each other. They bear with each other. They put up with each other's inadequacies and idiosyncrasies and eccentricities and faults and flaws and failures in love. I need about 59 of you on every platform to type, please put up with me. God is not through with me yet. These Ephesians Christians sought to actually live out in practical terms, Jesus' new commandment stated in John 13, 34, and 35, a new commandment I give to you. And what is that? Follow the Ten Commandments? No. Here it is. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. And everybody will know that you are my disciples, not because you speak in tongues, not because you claim a five-fold ministry, not because you're trying to be deep, not because you got four or five what would Jesus do bracelets around your wrist or three or four great big crosses around your neck. They'll know you are my disciple because you love one another. The city of Ephesus knew this. And as a result, many turned to Christ because they saw the love that the believers had for each other. John Calvin, a great church father and theologian, wrote about this saying, observe here that under faith and love, Paul sums up the whole perfection of the Christian life. My friends, when faith and love are paired together in a church, we have something for which to thank God. This is what Paul was doing par excellence. Verse 16, he says, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I say this from time to time, especially about our church and the way in which the people of our faith community, our members, our guests, our constituents, those who are in our extended family, the way they have behaved during this pandemic is a reason for which I remember them in my prayers and have not stopped giving thanks to God for them. Paul's thanksgiving went on, and this apostolic effervescence is indeed a beautiful thing. This attitude is so typical of Paul, and it ought to typify you and me. I provided references in your outline where Paul shows this effervescent thanksgiving spirit that rested upon him in Romans 1:9, 1 Corinthians 1:4, Philippians 1:3-4, Colossians 1:3, 1 Thessalonians 1:2, 2 Thessalonians 1:3, Philemon verse 4. Do we thrill at hearing of the faith and love and service and generosity of others? Do we rejoice in others' spiritual attainments and achievements? Especially revealing, do we praise God when this is happening in places where we are not present or we are not the beneficiary? When it's happening at other churches and in other organizations, one of the joys I've had during this pandemic is an opportunity to fellowship with other pastors in my community in a way that was not possible for whatever reasons pre-pandemic. I rejoice at what God is doing, not just in our church, but in every church. St. John of the Cross put it this way, as far as everyone is concerned, many experience displeasure when they see others in possession of spiritual goods. They feel sensibly hurt because others surpass them on this road, and they resent it when others are praised. They feel insensibly hurt is what I should, or unsensibly hurt because others surpassed them on their throat and they resent it when others are praised. Paul's attitude calls us beyond that. It calls us upward. His is a heart and a mind and a disposition to be emulated and imitated. It is a fact that only those who we are thankful for or who are thankful for the spiritual achievement of others can truly pray for them. Let me say it more plainly. Only when you are thankful for how others are being blessed and what others are doing can you truly offer prayer for them. So Paul's celebrating heart moves from a preamble of praise to powerful petition. How should we pray for those that we love, our brothers and sisters in Christ, people in our family? This is beautifully answered in these verses by Paul's fervent example. Paul prays, write this down, there's a space for it, for a better knowledge of Christ. That's verse 17. To begin with, Paul prays that the Ephesians will develop a deeper knowledge of Christ. Let me read it to you. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Why? So that you may know him better. Knowing Christ is one of the New Testament's ways of describing saving faith. Jesus himself said in John 17:3, in his high priestly prayer, now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Those who know Christ have eternal life. Those who do not know Christ are without it. Now, what does knowing Christ involve? It involves knowing more than just facts about Christ. I know a lot, for example, about President Joseph Biden. I know where he went to school. I know his chronological history. I know his vocational history. I know how long he served in the Senate. I know that he was vice president for 8 years. I know a few of his strengths, a few of his weaknesses, but I cannot truly say I know Joe Biden. I know facts about Joe Biden, and the facts are helpful, but they are not enough. Likewise, knowing Christ involves more than just intellectual assent or passing acquaintance. I have met several famous people in my life. I have shaken hands with famous people. I've stood next to famous people. I've sized them up. I've chatted with them. I've taken pictures with them, but I do not know them, and they certainly do not know me. To truly know one another, there must be mutual knowledge and mutual exchange. And knowing Christ goes beyond even that. The word know here has an Old Testament heritage behind it, in which the word yada is used, which often express intimacy, as in sexual intimacy. In Genesis 4:1, when it says Adam knew his wife, that wasn't facts, and she conceived and bare Cain. That was intimate knowledge. It is the spiritual parallel of this that Jesus has in mind, the New Testament has in mind, when describing those who have eternal life. Tragically, there are many religious people who believe that they are Christians and yet do not know Christ in the sense of intimacy. This is what Jesus was talking about in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 7, verse 22 and following, when he said, "Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? And then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Apart from or away from me, you evildoers." So the question that must be asked is, do we really know Jesus? Are we really in Jesus Christ? Is he really in us? Does he know us? You want to read Galatians 4:9 and 1 Corinthians 8:3. Is there an intimate exchange between you and Jesus Christ? Of course, my brothers and sisters, the Ephesians knew Christ, but Paul is yet praying that they might know him better. Somebody ought to just type right there, know him better. That's the goal of every believer. The regular Greek word for personal knowing is gnosis, spelled beginning with a G, G-N-O-S-I-S. But here the word is intensified with the preposition epi, E-P-I. Paul is asking for epinosis, a real, deep, full, comprehensive, thorough knowledge of Jesus Christ. He describes it in Romans 3:20 and 1 Corinthians 13:12. Paul wants these beloved believers at Ephesus, who are so full of love and full of faith, to go deeper and deeper in the knowledge of Christ. That's why I'm here laboring from week to week, because that's my goal. Not just that you would have a superficial knowledge of Christ, but that you would know him more and more as the days and the weeks and the months pass. Here, Paul puts his emphasis on the great need of believers and the great need of the church. The wisdom and focus of the world might be summed up in two words: know yourself. And the focus of many, perhaps most Christians, is often the same. We are preoccupied with getting a knowledge of self and imposing our gestalt rather than coming to know Jesus Christ more and more. And as a result of focusing only on ourselves and not on the Savior, we are often stunted in our spiritual growth. God wants you to grow. If you miss everything else I say today, don't miss that. God wants you to grow. E.W. Bullinger said, "Instead of breathing this life-giving air of heaven, many people have their windows closed, their doors shut, and are surprised that they are asphyxiated with their own exhalation. They are breathing over and over again their own breath, from which all vitality has been extracted." The great need of any believer, of any church, whether it is healthy or not, is knowing Christ, an epinosis, a beautiful, better, deeper, fuller, more comprehensive knowledge of Christ. I have memorized only a few verses in the Greek, but Philippians 3:10 is one that I have memorized that I might know him. That is the key to all of life. To nona auton in the Greek, that I might know him. We ought to read the scriptures with an eye towards knowing him. We ought to listen to preaching with this in mind. We ought to pray for ourselves and for the church, for it is an apostolic spirit ordained prayer. We should know before moving to the next verses that Paul prays for the power of the Holy Spirit to do this in them, the spirit of wisdom and revelation, because deep knowledge of Christ can only come to us as the Holy Spirit ministers it. 1 Corinthians 2, verses 10 and 11 reminds us, it is the Spirit who searches all things, even the deep things of God. No one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. Ask for the Holy Spirit to build your epinosis, your deep, your full, your comprehensive knowledge of Christ, who said in Luke 11:13, how much more will your Father in heaven give you the Holy Spirit if you ask him? So Paul prays for them to have a greater knowledge of Jesus Christ. But notice in verses 18 and 19, he prays for better spiritual vision. From asking for a better knowledge of Christ, Paul moves on to request better spiritual vision. I pray that the eyes of your heart might be enlightened. That's verse 18a. In scripture, the heart is always referred to as the fulcrum of a person's being, the seat of their intelligence and will. Paul then asks that our spiritual center will be given spiritual vision. As in our physical life, so it is in our spiritual life, that virtually everything depends on our sight. King Zedekiah in the Old Testament had his eyes gouged out by the king of Babylon. He was taken to a fabled city, but saw nothing of her tiled palaces, hanging gardens, and brass gates. We don't need more truth or better truth. We simply need our spiritual eyes open to the truth that already surrounds us. Specifically, Paul asked that we would have our vision better regarding three things. Write them down: hope, riches, and power. I'm in verse 18. Observe the words in his prayer. I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. Can I break this down like a fraction, pull it apart for a moment? First, let's look at hope. Paul wants us to have a better vision of the hope to which Christ has called us. Our hope has its source in our election, that we are chosen by God, which took place before the creation of the world. It is sealed in us by the Holy Spirit, given as a sweet down payment. Remember the word I shared with you in the last lesson, an arabon, a guarantee of what is to come. This hope is the grand hope of being manifested, shown one day with Christ in glory. Romans 5:2 calls it the hope of the glory of God. Romans 8:17 says, now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs or co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we might also share in his glory. In Colossians 3:4, Paul wrote, when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Paul prays that they and we will take hold of this gigantic hope. Hope is the opposite of despair. It breathes a massive optimism. If you have hope in Christ, you have every reason to believe that tomorrow is going to be better than today and yesterday. One day we will stand with Christ at the final press conference of the universe, and our photograph is going to be taken with him, and we will look just like him. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, the text says, "Dear friends, now are we the children of God." It's not something I aspire to. The moment I believe, I became God's child. Now are we the children of God. And what we will be has not yet been made known. Or in the old translations, it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. This is our hope. Let me talk secondly about riches. Paul prays that our eyes will be open to what? As to the riches of the glorious inheritance in the saints. What he wants us to see is that we are God's riches. Somebody ought to type that. I am God's riches. I am God's possession. That's verse 14 that we have previously mentioned. F.F. Bruce, a biblical scholar regarding this, says, Paul prays here that his readers will appreciate the value that God has put on them. God's plan to accomplish his eternal purpose through them as the first fruits of the reconciled universe of the future, in order that their lives may be in keeping with the high calling, and that they may accept in grateful humility the grace and glory that God has lavished on them. Think about it for a moment. God owns all the heavens and numberless worlds, but chooses you and me as his treasure. Hallelujah. The redeemed are worth more than the universe. We ought to be delirious with this knowledge, with this truth. Paul prays that we will see it with our heart's eyes. How dare you threaten to give up when you are God's treasure? How dare you allow depression and disappointment and discouragement and delay and denial to steal your joy when you are God's treasure? He will perfect that concerning you. Let me move on to the third one, because I feel a preaching coming on there. And the third thing is power. Here, Paul outdoes himself as he stacks synonym upon synonym in an attempt to describe it. With the Greek synonyms inserted, verse 19 reads like this: "And his incomparably great power," the Greek word is dunamis, explosive power. For us who believe, that power, kratos, is like the working energia of his mighty strength, iskos. He uses synonym upon synonym to try to describe the power of God present in our lives. He has layered these synonyms to express as best he can the highest power available. He has exhausted his language describing the power of the resurrection. Look at verse 20. What we must see is that the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead can bear directly on our lives both now and at his appearing. This stupendous power changes us from the children of hell to the children of heaven and gives us practical victory in every area of our lives. I'm gonna need for about 100 of you now to just type victory in the chat space. We will see it visibly someday in the resurrection, but we can see it tangibly in our everyday lives right now. For no created power in the universe can do that beyond the power of God. It is only through the great power, that power, the working, his mighty strength, is this possible. And yet the same power is operating in and for those of us who believe right now. Paul told me to ask you, can you see it? Do you see what I see? See, the great spiritual blessing of verses 3 through 14 led Paul to the preamble of praise in verses 15 and 16 for the practical outworking of faith and love in this Ephesian church. This preamble gave way to his two-pronged prayer. First, starting in verse 17, he prayed that they would have a better knowledge of Christ, that we would know him better, epignosis, The more we see of Jesus, the more we will be drawn to him. And the more we are drawn to him, the more we become like him. Are you, am I, making this a part of our personal and corporate prayer? Here it is. Pray, God, I want to know you better. But then secondly, in verses 18 and 19, Paul prayed that they and we would have better spiritual vision regarding three things that I've just walked through, the great hope to which God has called us, that we will share in his glory, that our eyes would be open to the riches of the glorious inheritance that he has in the saints, that we are God's treasured inheritance, and thirdly, that his all-surpassing, almighty power is on us and will continue to be on us and operate through us until that day we see him face to face and are glorified. I hope you know this. I hope you see this at every level of your being and existence. Some years ago, I read a quotation from Armitage Robinson, one of the greatest Ephesian scholars to ever write, who said that Paul's spiritual vision made him the foremost of all the apostles. Since that time, I've come to believe this with deeper and greater conviction. We need, brothers and sisters, to have our eyes open, like the servant of Elisha, written about in 2 Kings 6, 15 through 17. We need to pray for the Holy Spirit of wisdom and revelation that our eyes might be open to see Christ more and more. If we pray this apostolic prayer, we will never, ever be the same again. You remember in that story in 2 Kings, Elijah's servant looked out and saw the armies of the adversary surrounding them and were terrified. He went and told the prophet, and the prophet prayed for him, Lord, open his eyes so he might see the real deal. And God opened his eyes and he looked out again and he still saw the armies of the adversary, but behind it, he saw the armies of heaven, angels surrounding the adversary on every side. And Elisha said to him, those who are with us are more than those who are with them. I pray, my friend, that God would open your eyes so that you could see you're already on the winning side, that no matter what you're going through, it's going to turn around for you sooner or later. Things will turn in your favor because you are a child of God. We can celebrate these things to the glory of God. On the bottom of your outline, there are group discussion questions that we prepared in our GPS fashion, because I would love for you to be able to discuss this message with somebody else. Our first question, in fact, it's how we started up on with this particular lesson, is this. I want you to think about, when have you felt the most empowered to achieve something that was significant to you? What gave you that strength or ability? How did it feel to tap into that power and accomplish whatever you accomplished? I want you to start by thinking through that question and asking yourself that. And starting today, I'm implementing a new part of this lesson. It's a part I'm calling Cross the Bridge. That you came to the bridge, I want to invite you in the next 7 days to cross the bridge. And here's how. I want you to ask God to show you somebody to encourage for the next 7 days. And then when God provides the opportunity, take it. Share this stream with one other person every single day and allow God to go to work in their lives, to change their lives, to transform their lives, that they might become who God created them to become. Would you cross the bridge with me? And I'll see you next week, same time, same platform. But don't come by yourself. Invite somebody, one a day. If it works for vitamins, it'll work for Bible study. May God bless you real good. I'm Pastor Lance Watson.